Okay. In 1937, a popular Yiddish song was translated by the great Jewish nurse Sammy Cohn and made a hit by the Gentile girls group, the Andrews Sisters. It became the famous group's first major hit, earning the girls a gold record, and it was the first ever for a female vocal group. It was Yiddish, a huge Yiddish hit. Be mir bist du schön, you are lovely, in English. The song is illustrative of this second lecture. Were it not for Jewish composers and lyricists, the classic standards of American popular music would be largely non-existent. Concerning the American songbook, the popular music from 1900 to the 1960s, into the 1960s, of the top 36 composers and lyricists of the music Americans sang during that time and even afterwards, 75% were Jewish and none were evangelicals, an overwhelming dominance by a tiny 2% of the American population. This musical gift to us from the genetic heirs of the Old Testament church is a blessing from God because of his common grace. Many of the great Jewish songwriters were not conscious of composing out of an Old Testament mindset or ethos, but rather composed just out of great God-given talent for appropriating a variety of themes and styles. They were masters of musical pastiche. Only a handful were observant Jews in any sense of the word. The fact reminds me of Job 21 and 22, where Job gives the common complaint that unbelievers prosper because of God's goodness. In Job 22, we read, "They said to God, 'Leave us alone. What can the Almighty do to us?' Yet it was God who filled their houses with good things." Despite rebellion, God gave these Jewish composers and lyricists success so that not only their houses, but our houses could be filled with good things, the American Songbook. These brilliant Jewish artisans lyricized biblical themes without proper attribution. Yet in all of this, we can see the beautiful and happy providence of God at work. But why the Jews? One answer is that God's grace to the Jewish people in giving them an abundance of intellectual and creative gifts and talents. One survey shows that by 2010, over 30% of the Nobel Prizes had gone to Jews, approximately 13 times higher than would be expected based on the size of their population. In his 2007 400-plus page book, Abraham's Children, Race, Identity, and the DNA of the Chosen People, John N. Time notes that multiple genetic studies and published papers, clearly controversial in our politically correct age, have shown that the Jews, particularly Eastern European Jews, are smarter and more creative than the general population in which they find themselves. And one DNA study published in 2005 showed that a Jew is six times more likely than other European and North Americans to be considered a genius. A musical anecdote. The lyricist Sandy Kahn tells the story that when he first met Cole Porter, who was a Gentile, at a fancy Hollywood party in the 1950s, the party host said to Kahn, "Cole Porter wants to meet you." Kahn wrote, "Instead of going up to Cole, I stood there transfixed. Finally, Porter came up to me and said, 'Sammy Kahn, I've always envied you.' And I said, 'You've envied me? Why would you possibly envy me?' And Porter said, 'The fact that you were born on the Lower East Side, if I'd been born on the Lower East Side, I would have been a true genius.'" Porter, of course, was from Peru, Indiana. Harvard geneticist Steven Pinker, a Jew and no stranger to controversy, told the New York Times it would be hard to overstate how politically incorrect the conclusion of one particular study was. It certainly was a thorough and well-argued paper, not one that could easily be dismissed outright. These genetic studies and surveys are intriguing to me as evidence of God's goodness to his historic people and through them to us. But there are other less scientific explanations offered for this remarkable gift from the Jews to America's musical life. And musicologists, sociologists, and historians have advanced these less scientific explanations. For instance, the ambition to succeed of the musically inclined immigrant Jew. Remember, we're talking about 1900 to 1940, 1950. So many of the Jews were immigrant whose parents were immigrant. Another explanation, the brutal tenement living conditions in New York City propelled the immigrant Jews out of that neighborhood. They wanted to escape. Another explanation, music was a pathway for assimilation into for the immigrant Jew who had no connections. They wanted to assimilate into the broad culture. Another explanation that's offered, and books are written about these explanations. The music entertainment business was dominated by Jews, so there was no anti-Semitism to encounter or confront. Another explanation, the Yiddish theater movement, Bir Mistu Shane, I just played that, created a song that created an atmosphere like this, provided a ready and willing training ground for creative Jews. Another explanation, music provided an emotional therapy for the immigrant Jew. And now, we're getting closer to the Old Testament church. After the destruction of the Jerusalem Temple by the Romans in 70 AD, the great Jewish diaspora or dispersion or destruction of persecution lasting 2,000 years began. Secular music, the music of the home and private life, was the vehicle for emotional and cultural survival for the Jews who were unable to express their Jewishness once sanctuary music ceased or became sporadic. By the time of the Reformation in the 16th century, three quarters of all the Jews in the world lived in Eastern Europe, Jewish heaven, to escape persecution. This Eastern Jewish culture was called Ashkenazic, which comes from the Hebrew proper name Ashkenaz, who was the great-grandson of Noah and the son of Gomer in Genesis 10, and was taken to be identified with the Phrygians in Jeremiah 51. Now, this is important in looking at American popular music because the vast, vast majority, over 90% of the composers and lyricists of the Jewish contingent of the American songbook have Ashkenazim roots. These Eastern European Jews read and took comfort in the promises of the Abrahamic covenant in Genesis 12 and Jeremiah 24. I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. But they also read of Egyptian enslavement and Babylonian exile and Roman destruction. So the Ashkenazim Jews saw their reality as being exclusively God's chosen people on one hand, but exiled from humanity on the other. Their identity was mixed, the ultimate insiders, but at the same time the world's permanent outsiders. This confused identity was reflected in their melancholic, minor tone music, accompanied by hopeful and wistful lyrics, the wailing and yet dancing, as Psalm 30 puts it. It is honest music that is found throughout the American songbook because it reflects the emotional vagaries of human life. And this leads me to the Old Testament church. I propose another explanation for the dominance of the Jewish contribution to our popular musical heritage, because none of these explanations get to the root of why the Jews, and not some other genetic or tribal group, wrote all this wonderful music and all these marvelous lyrics that have blessed millions for over a century. The explanation lies, I believe, in metaphysics, God's amazing promise to the Old Testament church that he will bless the world through them. An understanding of the biblical songbook roots of the American songbook begins with an understanding of Old Testament church music to the extent that we know it. That music was highly emotional and, in this respect, quite contrary to Greek or European music. Plato, the Greek, eloquently argued that the pure elements of music, melody and rhythm, should be strictly subordinated to words, because only the logos, rational discourse, words, can seek truth. European Christianity followed Plato with an abiding distrust of secular music and entertainment, and an everlasting concern that the emotional, the Dionysian power of music would distract us believers from reason, biblical revelation. The Jewish historian theologian Abraham Geiger wrote that as the Greeks had a higher sense of the beautiful, the harmonious, the symmetrical, the pleasing, the Old Testament Israelites were given a higher sense of spiritual, which gave them unique insight into the character and person of Yahweh and his teaching. The scriptures teach that the mission of the Old Testament church, among other things, was to convey this manifold insight to the rest of humanity, and much of that mission was done through song. The forte of the Old Testament church creative spirit lies not in the rational and plastic arts of philosophic speculation and sculpture and architecture, but in the emotional arts of poetry and music. This is part of God's plan of redemption for her. Do not create magnificent graven images, but do create magnificent music and poetry. We know that God enabled this music from the lives of Moses and David, Elisha, and even Paul. And the fact that God the Father expressed his love for his church in song in Zephaniah 3, as did God the Son in Hebrews 2. In a 1925 article in the magazine American Hebrew, George Gershwin, a non-observant Jew, commenting on the Jewish composers in the American songbook, said good music, quote, must have feeling, a quality possessed to a great degree by the Jewish people. The Hebrew chants possess a particularly plaintive wail, which gives them a universal appeal. Men like Al Jolson, Eddie Cantor, owe their great success to the intense Jewish feeling they possess for melody, end of quote. Gershwin must have been referring to the Jewish wail of the Old Testament church, which is mentioned almost 650 times in the Bible. the wailing and longing undertone of Old Testament church music was given a modern reference in 1920s when a young but already successful Richard Rodgers met the older and still unsuccessful Cole Porter in Venice, Italy. Dining with Noel Coward, Richard, and Mary Rodgers, Porter peppered Rodgers with questions about theatrical success. The Jewish Rodgers was typically generous with advice and encouragement. At the end of the evening, Porter confided to the party that despite his failures on Broadway, that night he had figured out the secret of writing hits. I'll write Jewish tunes. Rodgers laughed, but later realized that Porter was serious and had been right. Porter's future hits, such as Night and Day, You'd Be So Easy to Love, In the Still of the Night, and So in Love, would be, quote, minor key melodies which are unmistakably Eastern Mediterranean, end of quote. Rodgers would later note in his autobiography. Scriptures teach that there is a special relationship between the present-day Jews and our Lord. Israel's electing promises and covenant with Yahweh were unconditional and have never been annulled, nor will be annulled. The Bible speaks of a difference between individual salvation in the paradise and the tribal election from Yahweh. In the New Testament, Paul the Jew clearly states that in Romans 9, that Gentile believers in Jesus are to be counted as Abraham's descendants and are now considered spiritual Israelites. So we Gentile believers have been adopted into the true tribe of Yahweh, and we praise the Lord for that. But Paul also recognized the ethnic importance and election of Abraham's biological seed. In Romans 9 and 11, Paul contrasts the theology of soteriology for the true Israelites, of which he has more recently become, with the theology of the election of the tribe of Israelites into which he was born. In an extraordinary passage, Paul states in Romans 9, my own race, the people of Israel, theirs is the adoption of sons. Theirs the divine glory, the covenant, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, the promises, the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of Christ, who is God over all, forever praised. But Paul is not speaking only spiritually, but culturally and morally, as his own race provides blessings to the world on behalf of her God, the greatest blessing, of course, being Christ, who is God over all. But there are other blessings as well. There is something special about being a tribal Jew, and Paul is proud of his genetic code of being an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin, as he states in Romans 11. Paul is writing about the hardening of the heart of the tribes of Israel in 11:29, in the context of election and the saving of Israel. He states in a reference to his ancestral tribe, for God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. John Calvin, in his commentary on Romans 11:29, notes that Paul here is not referring to, quote, tribal election of any individual, but rather the common adoption of an entire nation, which to outward appearance might have seemed to have fallen for a time, but which had not been cut off by the roots. In Romans, Paul argues that God has not wholly turned his kindness away from the Jewish people, but in his sovereign will, chose the Jews to be his people, and just because they have been disobedient for a time, a long time, does not mean that they have ceased to be his people. The genetic seed of Abraham lost the blessing of being God's unique, redemptive family when they turned from him, but they did not lose his love, his faithfulness, and his election. Otherwise, God's word would mean nothing if our sin can abrogate our covenant with him, as Paul states in Romans 3. What if some Jews did not have faith? Will their lack of faith nullify God's faithfulness? Not at all. Let God be true and every man a liar. Now, concerning the Jewish election and the American songbook. In an age when the world and the church are confronting forces that seek to rearrange the created relationship between male and female, the musical genetic heirs of the Old Testament church provide a ready and easily accessible weapon to foster the God-given love between a man and a woman, the melodic and the brilliant love songs of the American songbook. The songbook is a special blessing from God, largely through Jewish composers. Not entirely, but largely through Jewish composers and lyricists. And I circle around to where I began this lecture. God tells Abraham, I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. Blessedly, God didn't have to turn to stone to make musical sons of Abraham, as John the Baptist warned in Luke 3. He just turned to the European Ashkenazims, who were already genetic sons of Abraham, to give us this beautiful music. So the American songbook is really God's promised gift to us through his chosen tribe. If we want to enjoy the biblical songbook's canon of love ballads, we turn to the extraordinary collection of love songs in the Song of Songs. Keying off Proverbs 30:19, the wonderful and incomprehensible way a man with a young woman, the Song of Songs is an explicit illustration of love language between a man and a woman. Contemporary Old Testament scholars who have studied the song see an anthology of anywhere from a handful of love songs to over 30 love songs. Significantly for us, these Old Testament scholars have concluded that Solomon did not write the book, but rather, the most honest appraisal is that we do not know who wrote the book, whether it's a man or a woman, but in any case, it is a collection of love poetry. This conclusion tells us that the Old Testament church sang intensely romantic secular love songs to each other. The Song of Songs is a book extraordinarily rich in sensual imagery. There is nothing more essential to understanding the attitude of romantic love in the Old Testament church than a willingness to see biblical sensuality and romance recorded in the song. By far the most prevalent sensory metaphor in the Holy Text is visual, the sight of the lover's body thrilling the other lover's heart. But the language of love in the song also contains the eroticism of aroma, of taste, of sound, and of course, of touch, all to enhance the passion felt by one lover for the other. While there are several ways of looking at the thematic content of the song collection, there are at least six basic romantic themes of love lyricized in the song, which are also lyricized in the American songbook, all of written by Jewish composers and lyricists. There is the theme of imploring one's lover to come to you. There is the theme of secret and confidential love. There is the theme of searching or yearning for a lover. There is the theme of love in the midst of a hostile world. There is the theme of praise for the power of love. And there is the theme for mutual admiration society. So first, the theme of imploring one's lover to come to you. Chapter 2, Love is in Bloom, a dialogue song between two lovers in the song. She begins, the sound of my lover, see he is coming, leaping over mountains, bounding over hills. My lover is like a gazelle or a young stag. He is now standing behind our wall, staring through the window, peeking through the lattice. My lover spoke and said to me, and this is him, arise, my darling, my beautiful one, and come with me. See, the winter is past, the rains are over and gone. Flowers appear on earth, the season of song has come. The cooing of doves is heard in our land. The fig tree formed its early fruit. The blossoming vines spread their fragrance. Arise, come, my darling, my beautiful one. Come with me, my dove, in the cliffs of the rock, in the hiding places on the mountainside. Show me your face and let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your form is lovely. The American songbook ballad Love is a Many Splendored Thing was written by Sammy Fain and Paul Francis Webster for the 1955 movie Love is a Many Splendored Thing, winning the Academy Award for the Best Original Song. Here are the Four Aces singing the number one song in America for all of 1955. Thank you.
that only grows in the early spring. Love is nature's way of giving a reason to be living. The golden crown that makes a man a king. And the world's to sleep. And your fingers touch my silent heart and taught it how to sing. Yes, true love of any splendor.
There's a second poem of imploring a lover. I mean, there are many, but the second one I've chosen is from the fourth chapter. The man, crazy with love, chases the woman. He, come with me from Lebanon, my bride, with me from Lebanon come, down from the top of Amana, from the top of Senir and Hermon, from the dens of lions, from the heights of leopards. You drive me crazy, my sister, my bride. You drive me crazy with one glance from your eyes, with one jewel from your necklace. You go to my head is a 1938 Tin Pan Alley song composed by Fred Coots and Haven Gillespie and sung here by who else? Frank Sinatra. The lyrics reflect a pain to romantic infatuation packed with similes relating to love, relating love to champagne, burgundy, and mint juleps. The gorgeous song comes close to capturing the feeling of losing control and being completely intoxicated with love. Second theme, secret love between two lovers. Chapter 8, she says to him, sneak away with me. He, you who dwell in the garden, companions are listening, let me hear your voice. She, sneak away, my lover, and be like a gazelle or a young stag on a mountain of spice. This rhapsodic Hart and Rodgers and Hart 1933 ballad, You Are Too Beautiful, was made into a hit by Bing Crosby in 1933. But here it is sung by the wonderful Johnny Harmon, who sings of finding his lover after sneaking away.
You are too beautiful, my dear, to be true. Now I am a fool for memory. Who by a feeling that because I have found you, I could have bound you to. You are too beautiful for one man alone, or one lucky fool to be with. When there are other men with eyes of their own to see.
Third theme, a yearning for my lover. She yearns for him. She is speaking. On my bed at night, I searched for the one my soul loved. I searched for him, but did not find him. I will get up and go around in the city, in the streets, the public areas. I will search for the one my soul loved. I searched, but did not find him. The guards found me and those who patrolled the city. Have you seen the one my soul loves? It was a little while after I left them that I found him, the one my soul loves. I grabbed him and would not let him go until I brought him to my mother's house, to the room where she conceived me. In 1941, Richard Rodgers and Larry Hart wrote the score for Pal Joy, which was their longest running Broadway play. The best known song from the play is Bewitched, Bothered, and Bewildered, and it depicts the physical sensation of love sung as a monologue by a woman. And here is the sleepless but clinging Barbara Streisand.
Thank you. to him. Each spring to him and love for the day when I cling to him. I am bewitched by the moon, so bewildered.
Fourth theme, love in a hostile world. Chapter 8, the family says you're too young for love. Our sister is small and she has no breasts. What should we do for our sister on the day she is spoken of? But if she is a wall, we will build her a silver battlement for her. But if she is a door, we will enclose her with a cedar board. She responds to her brothers, I am a wall, and my breasts are like towers. Thus I will be in his eyes, like one who brings peace. Alan Lerner always said his favorite lyric was Gigi. He and Tribuclo wrote it for a wealthy but bored young Parisian who thinks Gigi as nothing more than a charming child. The song portrays his dramatic realization that this child has become so attractive that he wants her to be his wife and not his courtesan. From denouncing his infatuation for a silly child, he comes to realize that she is a full-grown woman, and he is in love with her. And here is Vic Damone singing to Gigi as the young creature.
Am I a fool without a mind, or have I merely been so blind to realize? Oh, Gigi, why you've been growing up before my eyes. Gigi, you're not at all that funny, awkward little girl I knew. Oh no, overnight there's been a breathless change in you. Oh Gigi, while you were trembling on the brink, was I out yonder somewhere blinking at a star? Oh Gigi, have I been standing up too close or back too far? When did your sparkle turn to fire and your warmth become desire? Oh, what miracle has made you the way you are?
Fifth theme, in power of love. He praises the power of love. Under the apple tree I aroused you. There your mother conceived you. There the one gave you birth conceived you. Set me like a seal on your heart, like a seal on your arm. For stronger than death is love. Tenacious like the grave is jealousy. Its flame is an intense fire, a godlike flame. Many waters are not able to extinguish love, nor rivers flood it. Even if a person gave all his wealth of his house for love, it would be completely despised. The American songbook album, My Old Flame, is a 1934 smooth and sensuous church song written by Sam Coslow for Mae West. The song speaks of a loss in love which can't be forgotten, however. Author and jazz critic Ted Gioia calls this song a melancholic and evocative work that ranks among the most well-crafted songs of his era. Matt Monro, subbing for Mae West, sings the song the way our Solomonic Man might have sung if he was backed by a huge orchestra. Maybe Nebuchadnezzar's Royal Babylonians.
The music seemed to be so reminiscent. I knew I'd heard it somewhere before. I wrapped my recollections as I listened, when suddenly I remembered once more my old flame. I can't even think of her name, but it's funny now and then how my thoughts go flashing back again to my old flame, my old flame. My new lovers all seem so tame, for I haven't met a girl so magnificent or elegant as my old flame. I've met so many who had fascinating ways, a fascinating gaze in their eyes. Some who took me up to the skies, but their attempts at love were only imitations of my old flame. I can't even think of her name. I'll never be the same until I discover what became of my old flame.
Sixth and final theme, Mutual Admiration Society, Chapter 4. How blessed we are to have each other. How beautiful your love, my sister, my bride. How much better your love than wine and the scent of your oils and spices. Your lips drip honey, O bride. Honey and milk are under your tongue. The scent of your garments is like the scent of Lebanon. You are a locked garden, my sister, my bride. You are a locked garden, a sealed fountain. Your shoots are a garden of pomegranates with choice fruits, henna and nard, and saffron, calamus, and cinnamon, and every kind of incense, tree, myrrh, and aloes, and all the chief spices. You are a garden fountain, a well of living water streaming down from Lebanon. She responds, wake up, north wind, and come, south wind, blow on my garden, and let its spices flow forth. Let my lover come into his garden and eat his choice fruits. He responds to her, I have come into my garden, my sister, my bride. I have gathered my myrrh with my spices. I have eaten my honeycomb with my honey. I have drunk my wine with my milk. As Mel Torme puts it, when Jerome Kern composed the dialogue ballad They Didn't Believe Me in 1914, he invented the popular song. It is arguably the most influential entry in the American songbook canon. Prime Minister of Britain, David Lloyd George, called it the most haunting and inspiring melody I have ever heard. The song inspired the 16-year-old musician, George Gershwin, who was attending his aunt's wedding reception at the Grand Hotel in New York when he heard the band play They Didn't Believe Me. Gershwin asked the band leader, who wrote that? When he heard the answer, it convinced him that he should become a composer so that he could write songs like that. Quote, I followed Kern's work and studied every song he composed. I paid him the tribute of frank imitation and studied each song, frank invitation, and many things I wrote in that period sounded as though Turn had written them. Here is the great Jack Jones singing solo this great song.
And when I told them how beautiful you are, they didn't believe me. They didn't believe me. Your lips, your eyes, your cheeks, your hair are in a class beyond compare. You're the loveliest girl that one could see. And when I tell them, and I'm certainly gonna tell them, that I'm a man whose wife one day you'll be, they'll never believe me. They'll never believe me. That's from this great big world you've chosen me.
The artistic bequest of the Old Testament church to the 20th century American popular music is alive and flourishing in the American songbook. Just as in life now, throughout the music of the biblical songbook, there's a mixture of lament and praise, of complaining and rejoicing, of anger and kindness, of love and hate, of satisfaction and frustration, romance, eroticism, consummation of a loving relationship between a man and a woman. There is the narrative of human life under the curse of Adam, and no body of popular music, lyrically or melodically, expresses that narrative as compellingly and as brilliantly as the Great American Songbook. And it is God's wonderful gift, largely through the heirs of the Old Testament church. I end this song, in this lecture, with another Gershwin song, Isn't It a Pity? The captivating 1933 ballad, Isn't It a Pity, from the failed George Gershwin Broadway musical, Pardon My English, is a gorgeous duet that deserves attention. George Gershwin's enchanting music with very clever Ira lyrics make this song deeply romantic, especially the words, let's forget the past, let's both agree that I'm for you and you're for me. These are reconciling words for every married couple who from time to time fight. The song was recorded for the first time in 1987 by the keeper of the American Songbook, Flame, Michael Feinstein, and the marvelous Rosemary Clooney. I find it hard to imagine any improvement. But I'll play this at the end. That ends the lecture. So, questions, comments?
Very interesting.
Oh. Well, you're insulting, yes. All right.
This is a great song.
Why did I wander here and there and yonder, wasting precious time for no reason or rhyme? Isn't it a pity? Isn't it a crime? My journey's ended, everything is splendid, meeting you today has given me a wonderful idea. Here
Your hand in mine, a perfect fit.
just think of it.
Isn't it a pity we never met before? Imagine all the lonely years I've wasted fishing for salmon, losing at backgammon. What joys untasted, my nights were sour, spent with Schopenhauer. Let's forget the past, let's both agree that I'm for you and you're for me. And it's such a pity we never, 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 never met before.
Bob, I thought you said this was honest music. Rosemary Clooney never read Schopenhauer in New York.
Well, I do. It used to be weekly, now it's occasional. It's a 5-minute program on the American Songbook. And so what I'll do is I'll take some of these anecdotes and play the music, tie it into a hymn, and tie it into a theological doctrine like I'm doing here. 5 minutes isn't very long, so I move it pretty fast. I just cover one or two things. So, but it's recorded in Seattle at Salem Broadcast, Salem Studios, and then it's run over World Magazine Radio, World Radio, and then it's on about 450 stations on the East Coast. But if you listen to Sunnyside Christian Radio Station, you can get it at Sunnyside. And then that, you have to get on the computer.
Are all those on your blog? All of those.
Yes. Yeah. They're all on my blog. Yeah.
Say, Bob, another radio plug might be for those who aren't familiar. Saturday nights, University of Washington, KULW, on frequency 94.9 for the last, well, the longest radio program actually in Puget Sound is The Swing Years and Beyond. And it's been a little secret soundtrack on Saturday nights in our household for 30 plus years, just playing the Great American Songbook from The Swing Years and for the back. That's it. You can get introduced to a lot of this.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.